शरन्ति सिन्धवः माध्वीर्नः सन्तवोषधिः माधो नक्तं उतोषसः मधुमत्पार्थिवं रजः मधुद्योरस्तु नः पिता मधुमान्नो वनस्पतिः मधुमानस्तु सूर्यः माद्वीर्गावो भवन्तु नः माद्वीर्गावो भवन्तु नः हरि ॐ असतो सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतम् उदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते वशिष्यते ॐ शान्तिः 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 गुणगान करिए राम धरिए राम का गुणगान करिए राम का
અમિતાબેન, હું દિવેટિયા સાહેબને વિનંતી કરીશ કે મહેમાનોને મંચ ઉપર આપ લઈ જાઓ.
22માં પ્રાધ્યાપક રામલાલ પરીખ સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાનમાં ઉપસ્થિત સહુ આદરણીય શ્રોતાજનોને વંદન અને આવકાર. ફેલાયેલ મહાવ્યધિને કારણે આ વાર્ષિક વ્યાખ્યાનમાળામાં આપ સહુને આમંત્રવાનું અને પ્રત્યક્ષ મળવાનું લાંબા સમયાંતરે થાય છે. વચ્ચે 21મો વ્યાખ્યાન ઓનલાઈન વ્યવસ્થા દ્વારા યોજાયેલું. આપ સૌ જાણો છો તેમ આ વ્યાખ્યાનમાળા ભારતીય સમુદાય શિક્ષણ સંઘના સ્થાપક સ્વર્ગસ્થ રામલાલભાઈ પરીખની સ્મૃતિમાં પ્રતિવર્ષ તેમની પુણ્યતિથિએ કે તેના નજીકના સમયમાં ગોઠવાય છે. તેમનું જીવન કાર્ય મુખ્યત્વે ગાંધીજી દ્વારા સૂચવાયેલા જીવનમૂલ્યો તેમજ શિક્ષણ વિચારોનો તેના મૂળ ભાવની સાથે સમાધાન કર્યા વગર જમીની સ્તરે સમય અને સમાજની અસ્થગિત આવશ્યકતાઓ તેમજ જરૂરિયાતો સાથે જોડી સાંકળી સ્થાનિકથી માંડી વૈશ્વિક સ્તરે તેમનો સમાજ સ્વીકાર કરાવવાનું રહ્યું. જો કે તેમનો કાર્યવિસ્તાર આ સિવાય સમાજ સેવાના અન્ય વિભિન્ન ક્ષેત્રોમાં પણ રહ્યો અને તે પણ નોંધપાત્ર અને પ્રભાવજનક રીતે. આ સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાનો સ્વર્ગસ્થ રામલાલભાઈના રસના વિષયોને કેન્દ્રમાં રાખીને ગોઠવાતા આવ્યા છે. રવિન્દ્ર વર્મા અને મોહન ધારિયા જેવા વિચારક રાજનેતાઓ, ડૉક્ટર સ્વામિનાથન અને ડૉક્ટર મશેલકર જેવા વિજ્ઞાનને બૃહદ સમાજની જરૂરિયાત સાથે જોડનારા વૈજ્ઞાનિકો, ડૉક્ટર કરણસિંહ અને પૂજ્ય મુરારીબાપુ જેવા વિચાર અને આસ્થાના દોન ધ્રુવ પર ઊભા રહી સમાજને પોતાના દ્રષ્ટિબિંદુથી દોરવણી આપનાર સમાજસેવકો, ગાંધીજીના દત્તક કુટુંબી એવા રાહુલ બજાજ તથા વીરેન શાહ જેવા નામી ઉદ્યોગપતિઓ, લોર્ડ ભીખુભાઈ પારેખ અને ગાંધીજીના પૌત્ર રાજમોહન ગાંધી જેવા પ્રબુદ્ધ વિચારકો અને સમીક્ષકો, અશોક વાજપેયી અને ગુણવંત શાહ જેવા સાહિત્ય સર્જકો, પવન વર્મા અને નેઝરથ જેવા ડિપ્લોમેટ્સ, યોગેન્દ્ર યાદવ અને મૃણાલ પાંડે જેવા માધ્યમો સાથે સક્રિય જોડાયેલા કર્મશ કાર્યશીલો અને આર્યરત્ને અને યુહાન ગાલ્ટુંગ જેવા આંતરરાષ્ટ્રીય ફલકે કામ કરનાર બિન ભારતીય મહાનુભાવોએ વિવિધ વિષયો ઉપર આ વ્યાખ્યાનમાળામાં વક્તવ્યો આપ્યા, જે બહોળો સમાજ સ્વીકાર પામ્યા અને સીમા વિનાનું શિક્ષણ તથા વિચાર વ્યોમના મેઘધનુષ નામે પુસ્તકાકારે પણ પ્રસિદ્ધ થયા. કાયદા અને ન્યાય ક્ષેત્ર સાથે વ્યાવસાયિક રીતે જોડાયેલા એવા આપણને આ બીજા વક્તા પ્રાપ્ત થયા છે. અગાઉ ન્યાયમૂર્તિ ચંદ્રશેખર ધર્માધિકારી અને આજે ન્યાયમૂર્તિ અકિલભાઈ કુરેશી. નોંધપાત્ર સરખામણીની બીજી બાબત એ છે કે આ બંને મહાનુભાવોએ તેમના પોતાના વિષય શીર્ષકમાં ગાંધીજીનો સ્પષ્ટ નામોલ્લેખ કર્યો અને બંનેના પોતપોતાના કુટુંબ વડીલો ગાંધીજી અને તેમના આંદોલનો સાથે પ્રત્યક્ષ અને ઘનિષ્ઠ રીતે સંકળાયેલા રહ્યા. જો ન્યાય એ ગંતવ્ય હોય તો તે સ્થાનનો અધીશ સત્ય જ હોય. સત્ય કદી અન્યાયી ન હોઈ શકે, તેમજ ન્યાય સર્વસમાવેશી સત્યને કેન્દ્રમાં રાખ્યા વગર ટકાઉ અમલી સ્વરૂપ ધારણ ન કરી શકે. ન્યાયમૂર્તિ કે ન્યાયાધીશની પદવી આ રીતે જોઈએ તો એવા સમાજ અગ્રણીને શોભે જેમણે પોતાના વ્યાવસાયિક કે વ્યવહારિક ક્ષેત્રોમાં સ્વાભાવિક રીતે ન્યાય અને સત્યનું પાલન કર્યું હોય. કાયદો હોવો માત્ર પૂરતું નથી, તેનામાં તેના અનુશાસન માટેની નૈતિક અધિકૃતતા પણ હોવી જોઈએ. આમ કહેનાર અને માનનાર ન્યાયમૂર્તિ અકીલ હમીદભાઈ કુરેશી પણ અત્યારના સમયમાં આપણી સમક્ષ સત્ય પ્રમાણિત નૈતિકતા અને તેનાથી દોરવાતા ન્યાયના ઉદ્ઘોષક અને પ્રહરી તરીકે ઉભર્યા છે, જે સર્વ કોઈ જાણે છે, સ્વીકારે છે. ભારતીય સમુદાય શિક્ષણ સંઘ પોતાનું સદભાગ્ય માને છે કે તેમણે આ 22મું સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાન આપવાનું સ્વીકાર્યું. હું સંસ્થા વતી અને સમગ્ર શ્રોતાજનો વતી ન્યાયમૂર્તિ અકિલભાઈ કુરેશીને આવકારું છું અને તેમનો ઋણ સ્વીકાર કરું છું. મુરબ્બી લોર્ડ ભીખુભાઈથી આ સભા ભલી ભાંતિ પરિચિત છે. લંડન સ્થિત હોવા છતાં પ્રતિવર્ષ લગભગ આ જ સમયગાળા દરમિયાન તેઓ માદરે વતન ભારતમાં આવે છે. રજા ગાળવા નહીં, પણ અહીં ચાલી રહેલ વિચાર વલોણામાં પોતાનો એક આગવો નિતાંત બુદ્ધિતર્ક પ્રેરિત અને ડાહ્યો વિચાર સમાજ સમક્ષ રજૂ કરવા માટે સતત વિચારશીલ અને અધ્યયનશીલ રહેતા અને વૈશ્વિક વૈચારિક વિમર્શથી માહિતગાર રહેતા તથા તેમાં પ્રદાન આપતા રહેતા લોર્ડ ભીખુભાઈ અગાઉ આ સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાન પણ આપી ગયા છે. તેમનો અમારી સંસ્થા પ્રત્યેનો પ્રેમ અને તેમની સહજ સાલસતા છે કે તેમણે આ વર્ષના સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાનના કાર્યક્રમના અધ્યક્ષ થવાનું બિલકુલ સરળતાથી સ્વીકાર્યું. તેમનાથી વધુ અધિકૃત અધ્યક્ષ અમને આજના સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાન માટે સાંપ્રત નહીં. હું તેમનો પણ સંસ્થા વતી તેમજ આ સભા વતી આવકાર કરું છું અને સાદર આભાર માનું છું. હું કોન્સ્ટિટ્યુશન ઓફ ઇન્ડિયા ઇઝ ઇટ ફૂલફિલિંગ ધ ડ્રીમ ઓફ ગાંધીજી વિષય ઉપર ગોઠવાયેલા આજના સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાનની કાર્યવાહી આગળ ચાલે તે પહેલાં સૌ સભાજનોને વિનંતી કરીશ કે કાર્યક્રમમાં દખલ થાય તે રીતે સભાખંડમાં અવરજવર ટાળે અને પોતાના વીજાણુ યંત્રોને ધ્વનિ શાંત રાખે. હું હવે ભારતીય સમુદાય શિક્ષણ સંઘના અધ્યક્ષ મુરબ્બી પીજે દિવેટિયાને વિનંતી કરીશ કે મહેમાનોનું સ્વાગત કરે અને સંસ્થા વતી તેમને સ્મૃતિચિહ્ન આપે, જે અમને નવજીવન પ્રકાશનના સૌજન્યથી પ્રાપ્ત થયું છે. એની વિશિષ્ટતા એ છે કે મશહૂર શિલ્પી સ્વર્ગસ્થ કાંતિભાઈ પટેલને તેમણે પોતે દોરેલ ગાંધીજીના પેન્સિલ રેખાચિત્ર ઉપર તેમને ગાંધીજીએ હસ્તાક્ષર કરી આપેલ. ગાંધીજીએ આ સિવાય પોતાના રેખાચિત્ર ઉપર બીજે ક્યાંય હસ્તાક્ષર નથી કર્યા. મોરબી દિવેટિયા સાહેબ,
ઇન્વાઇટેડ ફ્રેન્ડ્સ એન્ડ ગેસ્ટ, આઈ એમ સોરી ટુ સે ધેટ આઈ કેનોટ ગેટ અપ એન્ડ સ્પીક વિચ આઈ શુડ બીકોઝ આઈ હેવ બીન રિસન્ટલી ઓપરેટેડ, બટ બીકોઝ ઓફ ઇન્વિટેશન ઓફ મંદાબેન I decided that I must attend this function. And the subject which has been given to our speaker, Sri Qureshi ji, is very interesting. It's, at the same time, it is rather difficult subject also. The subject says, Constitution of India, is it fulfilling the dreams of Gandhi ji? It's a very hard thing to describe, because Gandhiji's life was such that, though looking simple, but inwardly quite difficult. So, I'm sure Qureshi ji will do the necessary in handling the subject, will do justice to the whole thing. And I don't think I should speak more, but leave the mic
હું મંદાબેનને વિનંતી કરીશ કે આપણા મહેમાનોનું સ્વાગત કરે. ન્યાયમૂર્તિ અકિલભાઈ, આભાર મંદાબેન. હવે હું ન્યાયમૂર્તિ અકિલભાઈ કુરેશીને વિનંતી કરીશ કે સ્મૃતિ વ્યાખ્યાન આપે.
માન્ય ઉપસ્થિત સૌ વડીલો, મહેમાનગણ, લોર્ડ ભીખુભાઈ પારેખ, પરીક્ષિતભાઈ મંદાબેન, સૌ આમંત્રિત મહેમાનોનું સ્વાગત છે. વીજાણુ યંત્ર જેવી ગુજરાતી ભાષાને કક્ષા નહીં બોલી શકું, પણ શરૂઆતમાં થોડોક પરિચય માતૃભાષામાં આપવાનું મન થાય છે. જો કે મેં મંદાબેન પાસેથી પરવાનગી લઈને વધારે ભાગે વ્યાખ્યાન ઇંગ્લિશમાં બોલવાની છૂટ માગી છે, કારણ કે વિષય એવો છે કે એ ભાષામાં ડેવલપ થયો છે અને વિચાર રજૂ કરવા મારા માટે થોડો વધારે સરળ રહેશે. પણ શરૂઆતમાં કહું તો પરીક્ષિતભાઈના નિમંત્રણથી આજે હું અહીંયા આવ્યો છું, આપનો આભાર છે સાહેબ. મંદાબેનની માફી માગું કે ક્યારેક તમારા કોમ્યુનિકેશનને જવાબ આપવામાં મારાથી થોડું વિલંબ થયો હતો. આજે અહીંયા આવવામાં થોડોક ક્ષોભ, થોડી આઈ એમ ઓવરવેલ્મ્ડ. આ વ્યાખ્યાન માળાના ભૂતકાળના જે વક્તાઓનું લિસ્ટ જોયું, સૌ મહેમાનગણની અને મિત્રોની હાજરી, આઈ સમટાઈમ્સ વન્ડર વેધર આઈ વિલ બી એબલ ટુ ડુ જસ્ટિસ ટુ ધ ટોપિક વિચ હેઝ બીન ચોઝન. આઈ ટ્રાય માય બેસ્ટ. રામલાલભાઈને પ્રત્યક્ષ રીતે મળવાનો મારે જિંદગીમાં ક્યારેય મોકો નહોતો મળ્યો, પણ એમના વિશે વાંચ્યું, જોયું, એ ઉપરથી એક વસ્તુ મને બહુ ઊંડી છાપ પડી, જે આજકાલ જ્યારે પણ યંગ લોયર્સ કે યંગસ્ટર્સ સ્ટુડન્ટ્સને બોલવાનું જ્યારે મળવાનો વિચાર જ્યારે અનુકૂળતા મળે છે ત્યારે હું એક વસ્તુ ખાસ કહું છું કે તમે જિંદગીમાં બહુ વહેલાથી સુપર સ્પેશિયલાઇઝેશન ન કરો. ઓલવેઝ હેવ વાઇડર પર્સપેક્ટિવ. બહોળો અનુભવ, જુદા જુદા વિષયોનો, જુદા જુદા ફિલ્ડનો, સુપર સ્પેશિયલાઇઝેશનનો સમય એની મેતે આવશે. રામલાલભાઈને જિંદગી ઉપરથી એક વસ્તુ મેં જોયું કે એમની જે પ્રદાન હતું એ જુદા જુદા ફિલ્ડની અંદર, રમતગમતથી માંડી સાહિત્ય, વિજ્ઞાન, શિક્ષણ, અને બ્રૂડિંગ ઇન્ફ્લુઅન્સ ઓફ મહાત્મા ગાંધી ઓલ થ્રુ આઉટ. એટલે મંદાબેને જ્યારે આજનો વિષય મારા ઉપર છોડ્યો, આઈ એમ થેન્કફુલ ટુ હર ફોર દેટ. આઈ વોઝ થિંકિંગ ઓફ ચૂઝિંગ એન અપ્રોપ્રિએટ ટોપિક. હર ઓનલી રિક્વેસ્ટ દેટ વોઝ દેટ ઇટ શુડ બી સમથિંગ અપ્રોપ્રિએટ ટુ ધ લાઈફ એન્ડ ટાઈમ્સ ઓફ રામલાલભાઈ. ઓબ્વિયસલી દેટ વુડ બી ધ રિક્વાયરમેન્ટ. When I was debating in my mind what would be the appropriate topic, obviously Gandhiji's presence is so omnipresent for all of us, our generation and even later generations. And law and constitution being close to my heart, I was trying to amalgamate the two. And in the process, one very powerful thought occurred to me, and is this, that in the recent times, till the recent times, there was one question which kept propping up ever so frequently and periodically. Is Gandhi relevant today? Thankfully, that debate has been put to rest. The way in which all sections of the society, all organizations, political and non-political, of different ideologies and different use of beliefs, use Gandhiji's reference to mollify their beliefs must put this debate to rest forever. Gandhiji will continue to be relevant to this country and to this world as long as society does not achieve its full ideals of peace and non-violence. So the topic that came to my mind was Constitution of India. Is it fulfilling the dreams of Gandhiji? I very carefully chosen the word, is it fulfilling? It's not, has it fulfilled? Had it been the question, perhaps the debate would have been very short. And this allotted 50 minutes would have been too much for me. So I start with a caveat. I'm not a great student of Mahatma Gandhi's lives and times. There are people who have spent their entire life trying to understand Gandhiji's message and his life and his deeds. He touched so many subjects and so many areas of the society and so many people. It is impossible to fathom his life in just one lifetime. So I don't claim to be expert in Gandhiji's background, but what I've learned from his tryst with law, two or three instances which immediately pop in one's mind, is, as we know, Gandhiji went to South Africa after dabbling with legal practice in Porbandar, Rajkot and Mumbai quite unsuccessfully. He suddenly landed up in South Africa on an invitation in a legal dispute of business family settled of Indian origin settled in South Africa. And he continued there, again, parallelly, starting with legal practice, going on to the movement of anti-apartheid and rights of non-white population. In one of the cases, Gandhiji was defending his client Dada Abdullah. It had a shipping law dispute. Dada Abdullah had a fleet of sheep and his captain had sued for non-payment of certain charges, and claim was very substantial. And the judge was very hostile. At every stage, Gandhiji went on asking for adjournment, for discoveries, for inspection of documents, for permission to examine witnesses and cross-examine the witness of the other side. Every stage, the judge would stonewall his efforts. There came a stage where, in the full courtroom, the judge, out of rhetorics and frustration, said, "Have you read shipping laws?" Just think of the scenario. The court is full of lawyers and litigants. Gandhiji's own very important client is present. And he has to make a choice. He could have easily said yes and nobody would have ever found out. But Gandhiji's first partner in law in South Africa was one Mr. Cokes, who later on turned out to be a very unscrupulous lawyer, and Gandhiji quickly parted ways with him. What happened next is beautifully described by Charles DeSalvo, who has written a book called Man Before Mahatma. And he has described Gandhiji's about 20 years of life in South Africa before he achieved fame and greatness. And he says this: being forced by the judge to make a fundamental choice about who he was, as both a man and a lawyer, he could have said he had not read it and shown himself to be embarrassingly underprepared, or could have claimed that he had and find Cokes reborn in himself. Gandhi's answer, no, would help set his life's direction. He chose the truth and never let it go. This example is an inspiration for me to very often talk to youngsters and tell them that life will sometimes present difficult choices. The choice you make will define you as a person. Make sure you make a choice which later on you will be proud of, not ashamed of. The second incident which has left a deep impression on me about Gandhiji's philosophy and his ideals was, as we all know, the Great Trial. Gandhiji had written a series of articles in Young India criticizing the British government and its rule in India, unfortunate incidences of Chauri Chaura and other violent incidents took place. Gandhiji was tried for the offense of sedition. Trial was conducted in the outskirts of Gandhi Ashram, that old circuit house area, in tight security. After the Advocate General laid down the charges against Gandhiji, Gandhiji pleaded guilty. And he said, but I want to make a statement to the judge about why I took these steps. And some of his utterances, it's one of the finest speeches of the 20th century. I'll read just a small portion of that. He told the court, before I read this statement, I would like to state that I entirely endorse the learned Advocate General's remarks in connection with my humble self. I think that he was entirely fair to me in all the statements that he has made, because it is very true that I have no desire whatsoever to conceal from this court the fact that to preach disaffection towards the existing system of government has become almost a passion with me. In the statement that I am about to read, it would be my painful duty to admit before the court that it commenced much earlier. I wish to endorse all the blame that the learned Advocate General has thrown on my shoulders in connection with the Bombay occurrence, Madras occurrence, and Chauri Chaura instance. He is quite right when he says that as a man of responsibility, a man having received a fair share of education, having had a fair share of experience of this world, I should know the consequences of every one of my acts. I knew them. I would still do the same. I ran the risk that if I were set to free again, I would still do it. I would be failing in my duty if I did not say all that I said here before just now. I wanted to avoid violence. Non-violence is the first article of my faith. It is also the last article of my faith. But I had a choice to make. I had either to submit to a system which I considered had done an irreparable harm to my country, or run the risk of the mad fury of my people bursting forth when they understood the truth from my lips. I am here, therefore, to invite and submit to the highest penalty that can be inflicted upon me for what in law is a deliberate crime and what appears to me to be the highest duty of a citizen. The only course open to you, Mr. Judge, is, as I am going to say in my statement, either you resign from the post or inflict on me the severest penalty if you believe that the system and law you are assisting to administer are good for the people. By the time I have finished with my statement, you will perhaps have a glimpse of what is raging within my breast to run this maddest risk which a sane man can run. Three foundational principles of Gandhiji, which I discern from his teachings, are truth, compassion, and non-violence. Friends, with this kind of a personality in the background, the India, a nation to be born, set about the task of choosing a constitution which will place a mechanism for the independence, for development of the country. The first meeting of the Constituent Assembly was held on 9th of December 1946 under shadow of just completed Second World War, leaving the victor and vanquished both bleeding. Grossest possible human rights violations by the Nazi regime on the fellow human beings was fresh in the minds of the members of the Constituent Assembly. Partition of India was being increasingly clearer. Muslim League refused to participate in the Constituent Assembly. Under such uncertainty and shadow of violence and unpredictable events, the Constituent Assembly met. It comprised of some of the outstanding personalities of the time who had spent decades in public life, in freedom movement: Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, Dr. Ambedkar, Kanhaiyalal Munshi. These were the stalwarts who dominated the debates in the Constituent Assembly. There are 13 volumes, all documented. Every word that has been spoken, said, read, written is documented in 13 volumes called the Debates on the Constituent Assembly, which continue to guide us whenever we have some doubt about what the Constitution has said and sometimes deliberately left unsaid. We fall back on the debates and try to understand what the members of the Constituent Assembly wanted to convey. On 13th of December 1946, the Constituent Assembly adopted the resolution of the objects of the Assembly. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru presented the paper, and while doing so, he said, "The task, first task of this Assembly is to free India through a new constitution, to feed the starving people and to clothe the naked masses, and to give every Indian the fullest opportunity to develop himself according to his capacity. If we cannot solve this problem soon, all our paper constitution will become useless and purposeless." About Gandhiji's brooding presence, he said, "There is another person who is absent here and who must be in the minds of many of us today. The great leader of our people, the father of the nation, who has been the architect of this assembly and all that has gone on before it, and possibly of much that will follow, he is not here because in pursuit of his ideals, he is ceaselessly working in a far corner of India, but I have no doubt that his spirit hovers over this place and blesses our understanding." With these thoughts, ideals and morals, the Constituent Assembly went about the task of framing the constitution of a free India. The debates went on for nearly 3 years. Range of topics came up for discussion. Should India have a national language? What should be the national language? Hindi? What is Hindi? Today there is no definition of Hindi. There is Hindustani, there is Hindi which is spoken in Allahabad, is different from Hindi spoken in Lucknow. Should there be a national language foisted on this country? What kind of constitution shall we have? Shall we have a unitary structure or shall we have a federal structure? Should we have a strong center or should we have equally strong federal units? Citizenship was another contentious issue. The debate was, there were many people who had gone over to Pakistan at the time of partition. If they want to return, should they be accepted as Indian citizens? One school of thought was that those who went to Pakistan at the time of partition had abandoned the idea of India. They should not be welcome as Indian citizens when they find that the grass is not so greener on the other side of the border. With Gandhiji's influence looming large, the majority which prevailed was that most of the people who left India during the partition time was mostly under duress and not out of choice. Many of them had left their families behind when they wished to return to their homelands. This country is inclusive and would not reject their claims. Universal adult suffrage was a bold experiment for a young nation. Right to vote to every adult citizen without discrimination of race, religion, caste, creed, or gender was not achieved in more developed democracies for decades and centuries together. Blacks and women in America got voting rights much later. There was also a debate whether we should put a filter for holding elected public posts. Should a person have a minimum of education? Should he be a graduate? Should he at least be matriculated before he can hold an elected post of a sarpanch, taluka panchayat member, assembly member, or a parliament member? The idea was rejected on the ground that a person is not uneducated out of choice. He is uneducated because of circumstances. By taking away the right to govern himself, we subject him to greater prejudices and continued disparity and unfair treatment. Let them govern themselves, let them make their choices. They are the first people who would educate their children because they know what deprivation in life comes out of lack of education. An elite class who has got education and facilities and liberties presented to them would perhaps not be able to ever understand the plight of this class of the people. With these great thoughts and ideals, the Constitution of India was framed. Many of these had the imprint of Gandhiji. The untouchability was abolished. Fundamental rights chapter was specially dedicated. To protect fundamental rights, mechanism was created. Courts were empowered. Article 12 would say state and state its instrumentality, the reach of the court of writ would reach to these instrumentalities so that the executive can be kept within its legal and constitutional bounds. Article 13 was made to say that there shall be no law which is repugnant to fundamental rights, and all existing laws which are repugnant to fundamental rights will be null and void. Article 32, which Dr. Ambedkar described as the heart of the Constitution, gives right to a citizen to knock the doors of the highest court of the country on allegation of breach of fundamental rights. Article 226 of the Constitution gives the widest possible powers to the writ courts, the constitutional courts of India, the high courts, to issue any prerogative writ or direction to the state or its instrumentalities. But not as if all Gandhiji's ideas were accepted. Gandhiji's professed belief that village should be the unit of governance with rights of self-governance was not accepted in its entirety. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru led whose school of thought was that if India wanted to achieve social revolution, equality, modernity, it had to be independent. And to achieve this durable, enduring independence, India must have a strong center. And therefore the Constitution of India, which was framed and presented to the people, is seen as a quasi-federal structure. It acts as a federal constitution in normal times. It can quickly adopt to a unitary structure at the time of external aggression or any other challenges. Constitution was framed on 26th of November 1949, and therefore we celebrate 26 November as a Constitution Day. It was adopted as a Constitution of India on 26th of November 1950, and therefore our Republic Day. When the Constitution was framed, two of the leading personalities of the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Ambedkar and Rajendra Prasad, the chairman of the Constituent Assembly and the one who would go on to become the first president of India, both expressed similar sentiments in slightly different languages. They said that we have tried to make a good constitution and we hope that it has turned out to be a good document. But the success of working of this constitution will depend on the people who work it out. It may be a deficient constitution, but if the people who work the constitution have strength and character, they will make it a successful constitution. But even if you have made the best constitution, of people who work are the small people and cannot implement. It's possible to undermine the constitutional democratic institution without amending the constitution. The full success of this document, therefore, will depend on the kind of people who will work it, and therefore we need people of stature and character to work it out. The Constitution begins with the preamble, which says, "We the people of India solemnly resolve, besides other things, to achieve social, political, and economic justice for all." With this began the journey of a nation of half a billion people then, from the days of poverty, illiteracy, hunger, and malnutrition, to better future for all, and equal opportunity to all its citizens. It was an experiment in social restructuring through peaceful constitutional means, a revolution at a scale never attempted in the modern history of mankind. Think of the vastness of the nation, the diversity, cultural, historical, geographical, linguistic diversity of this great nation, to bind it together, to put in place a mechanism which would enable the rulers and the people themselves to eliminate class, creed, discrimination, prejudices suffered by certain classes since centuries, and bring about a peaceful social revolution. It was an audacious attempt, never imagined before, through democratic means. There may have been other polities in China and in Russia where revolutions might have taken place, but they were not bloodless, they were not peaceful. Friends, the working of the Constitution is made of small stories of some great significance and historic moments. These stories present sometimes hope, sometimes despair, sometimes dejection or disappointment, sometimes ecstasy. But all are fascinating stories. I'll try to present before you some of them, which I think were very interesting. As soon as the Constitution was framed, there was a huge demand for agrarian law reforms. Before independence, the land holdings were in hands of very few people. By whatever name you call, jagirdars, barkharidars, thakurs, landlords, the land holding in one person's hands or family was 1,000 acres or sometimes more. And these land holdings were subdivided into small tenancies where the tiller or the farmer who toiled day and night got a very little out of it. 1/3 or sometime 1/2 of the crop share the landlord would collect every year without even once having to visit the land that he owned in vast tracts. And this was not working out well even for agriculture, because the tenants did not have enough capital to invest and make the land more fertile and agriculture more productive. The landlords were sometimes hands in glove with the money lenders. So failed monsoon was a good sign, a good news, because the tenant would not be able to repay the debts for all these things which he has borrowed for a later promise to pay up the debts. And a small farmer, a tenant, would overnight be converted into a landless laborer or a bonded laborer for life. As soon as the democracy was installed, there was a huge demand for land reforms across the country. States upon states, Bihar, UP, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, brought land reform laws where the tenants became the deemed purchasers, the owners of the land. Zamindars as a class was abolished. The government of India stepped in the shoes of the zamindar, landlord, and maintained its eminent domain. Government of India did not have sufficient funds to pay for all these changes. And these laws were opposed tooth and nail by the zamindar lobby before different courts. Some of the courts struck down such acquisitions. This forced Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru ministry to bring constitutional amendment restricting the right to land, hold the property, which was one of the fundamental rights in Article 19. And thus, the Constitution of India underwent a first amendment before the country went for its first general election. And these amendments were challenged in the Court of Law, in Supreme Court. The first of the case, Shankari Prasad Singh Dev, 5-judge bench of Supreme Court, some very interesting debates took place. The question was, does the Constituent Assembly have a right to amend the Constitution? It's not an elected body, it was an indirectly elected body just to choose the Constitution. Should the task of amending the Constitution not be left to the elected members of the Parliament who would occupy those places? Can fundamental rights be amended at all? If so, to what extent? And all these debates were answered by first Constitution bench judgment of Shankari Prasad Singh Dev holding that the Parliament has the right to amend the Constitution, any part of it, including fundamental rights. And even the Constituent Assembly could do the same job. Not resting with that, the challenge came once again before the Supreme Court, 5-judge bench, again in case of Sajjan Singh. While affirming the law earlier laid down in Shankari Prasad Singh Dev, two judges sowed the seeds of some doubt. Justice Madholkar, for the first time, talked of basic structure or basic feature theory, which would later on be developed into a full-blown law of the land, which I'll come to later. But in this judgment, Madholkar said that there may be something like a basic structure which cannot be disturbed. But he left it at that, did not feel strong enough to differ from the earlier unanimous judgment. Justice Hidayatullah also sowed the seeds of doubt. He said that the fundamental rights chapter guarantees so many rights to the citizens. I doubt that these fundamental rights are a mere plaything of a majority. Beautiful expression. Can majority do or undo anything and everything? We'll talk about it later. He said, I doubt if all these rights are a mere plaything of a majority. The issue once again cropped up in IC Goloknath case. This time around, the bench consisted of 11 learned judges of the Supreme Court. By a majority of, rather sharp majority of 6-5, the Supreme Court held that no part of the fundamental rights are amenable to amendments, putting a complete seal on disturbing any of the guaranteed fundamental rights. But one thing they did, for the first time in Indian context, they introduced a concept of prospective overruling. What they said is that we are upsetting the law which has lasted for so long, and therefore we'll apply it prospectively. Leave it aside for a while. The government was not happy. It was thought that the courts are stonewalling the social changes which the executive wants to bring. And therefore, the matter was taken to a yet larger bench of 13 judges in famous case of Keshavananda Bharti, His Holiness Keshavananda Bharti. Once again, the fate of the debate which would touch the nation's every citizen was decided by just single vote. 7-6, it was held that yes, Parliament has the power of amendment of constitution including fundamental rights, but not to disturb the basic structure of the constitution. This basic structure or basic feature theory has stood the test of time. Just to complete the narration of events, Mrs. Gandhi was not satisfied with even this much of leverage. And therefore, without citing any reasons, the Chief Justice of India, which is not done, you refer a matter to larger bench for reasons, not otherwise. Without citing any reasons, it was referred to yet larger bench of 15 judges. And as the story goes, the arguments of one of the finest lawyers of the times, of those times, Nani Palkhewala, were thought to be so powerful that this larger bench was again dissolved without citing reasons. Be that as it may, this basic feature or basic theory, basic structure theory has stood the test of time and holds a field in Indian context today. Most significant impact of this judgment is that it puts certain parts of the Constitution of India beyond majoritarianism. The most important concept of any liberal democracy is that majority cannot ride the roughshod over minority simply because they have the larger numbers. There is something like wisdom, there is something like truth, there is something like justice, which cannot be jettisoned simply because majority of the people feel otherwise. Today, so many aspects of our constitution are considered to be basic feature or basic structure: secularism, rule of law, equality, judicial review, democratic system of governance. These are all beyond the pale of even Parliament's amending powers. So even if the entire Parliament were to unanimously hold that India is no longer a secular country, it could not do so. Friends, as you all know, soon after this judgment and supersession of some of the judges of the Supreme Court for Chief Justiceship, Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the then Prime Minister's election to the House of, to the Parliament, to the Lok Sabha, was set aside by a single judge of Allahabad High Court. Just see the beauty of our Constitution. The law takes its own course. A single judge of a high court can annul the election of the prime minister of the country if it's found to be illegal or hurt by any of the vices laid down in the Representative People's Act. Soon followed political uncertainty. Emergency was declared. Fundamental rights were suspended. All political opponents, union leaders, public workers, political personalities were put behind bars in large numbers. Under the laws of preventive detention, when a person can be locked up in jail up to 1 or 2 years without even citing any charges against him. All these detentions were challenged in different high courts. Government of India raised a ground that these petitions are not maintainable because fundamental rights are suspended. And that includes right to life and liberty, Article 21. Many of the high courts, including Bombay High Court, said Article 21 can never be suspended. This preliminary challenge was rejected. All these issues went to Supreme Court in ADM Jabalpur, Shivang Shukla versus ADM Jabalpur case. 5 judges bench was constituted. One of the questions put by the judges during the arguments to the then Advocate General Niren Day was, Mr. Day, your argument would amount to this, if a policeman were to shoot a person in the street by wrong identity, his relatives would have no remedy in law. His answer was, "My lords, that is what it would come to." And one of the darkest days of the Supreme Court of India, this was upheld by majority of 4-1. One single, courageous, lone, dissenting voice came from Justice H.R. Khanna. He said, Article 21 is not the sole repository of right to life and liberty. It inheres in every citizen of a civilized society. And therefore, even if you take away Article 21, you cannot take away his right to life and liberty. His dissent was not only significant, but glorious and courageous, because he was forewarned that if you go ahead and express your views, you will not be made the Chief Justice of India, which was his right by way of seniority. And despite this, he went ahead, expressed his opinion, and as threatened, he was superseded. He quickly resigned, and the New York Times wrote an editorial to this incident and said, "If India ever finds its way back to the freedom and democracy that were proud hallmarks of its first 18 years as an independent nation, someone will surely erect a monument to Justice H.R. Khanna of the Supreme Court of India." The moment, thus, which was the nadir in the history of this great institution of Supreme Court of India, also ironically presented its most shining moment. Friends, many things have happened since the days of ADM Jabalpur. Supersession of a Supreme Court judge for ascension to the position of Supreme Court Chief Justice of India has never been attempted again, and I hope we have seen the last of it. India has moved as a nation. This process of social restructuring, achieving social, political, and economic justice for all, is an ongoing process, an incomplete process, a work in progress. At the same time, India is developing into a modern nation. A nation which has also embraced capitalism to a large extent. It's a creative genius of this nation that those two seemingly parallel movements are still going on. And between these two extremes, we see the struggles of a society to find its identity. Across the country, courts, high courts and Supreme Court, are dealing with some very sensitive issues of what are the limits of law? What is the reach of law? To what extent the law can decide? Can the state power extend to deciding what I should wear, what I should eat, whom I should love, and how should I express my love? Sabarimala case, you all know. A lady went to the court and said that I cannot be barred from entering the temple because I belong to a certain age group which the temple authorities believe should not permit entry to women. Supreme Court at one stage upheld her rights and declared such practice as unconstitutional. In Nas Foundation, the gay rights have been accepted. What do adult conscientious citizens do in their privacy? The state has no business to disturb that. In Triple Talaq, Shaira Banu case, the age-old practice of divorcing a wife by just repeating the same word thrice has been held to be unconstitutional practice. A lesser-known case originated from our High Court of one Gulrukh Gupta. Gulrukh is a born Parsi to Parsi parents. Under Special Marriage Act, which is a secular law permitting two citizens to solemnize marriage without having to forego the religion, she has married a Hindu boy and therefore her name Gulrukh Gupta. She came to the Gujarat High Court and said that, look, my parents are aged. Someday one of or both of them are going to pass away. The Parsi Panchayat does not recognize me as a Parsi woman anymore. Though under the Special Marriage Act, I have not had to forego my religion. My husband continues to be Hindu. I continue to profess Parsi religion. But when my father or mother passes away, the last rites which are to be performed in the inner chamber, where Atish Behram, the sanctum sanctorium of the Parsi Agyari, they would not let me go because only a Parsi can enter that place, and declare this as an unconstitutional practice. The matter is now lying, I believe, in Supreme Court. Gujarat High Court, there was a split verdict. I was in minority. But there, in Supreme Court, the Parsi Council made a very interesting argument. And he said that 5 centuries back, my forefathers came from Iran and landed in a small village in the coastal town near Navsari in Sanjan. And the rulers of the day promised my forefathers that the state will not interfere in your professing your religion. Will 500 years later, the courts in India will tell me who is Parsi and who is not Parsi? My religion tells me Gulrukh is not Parsi. You cannot decide otherwise. Well, I'm not commenting on the theory or whether it's right or wrong. All I'm saying is that these are the fascinating aspects of our society which are being played out in different courts at different levels. And the society is in a constant state of change. With this, my friends, ladies and gentlemen, I leave the final verdict on this topic to you. While you do so, please bear in mind 2 thoughts. 1, I've always believed that whenever a generation is in harness, be it in the family, be it in the institution that you are part of, be it society, be it country, has not only the role to run the organization well, but also to provide for your succession, prepare a succession plan, that you do not have to turn around and say, this is not what I fought for. And once you put that succession in place, do not interfere. They have a right to make changes. So if your verdict is not so satisfactory, a part of the blame must go to you and me, the past generation who have played our innings. And the second thought is, my friends, by no means India is not an immature democracy, but is a nascent democracy. 75 years in the history of a republic, in the times of republic, is too short to write its history. Give it some more time. Thank you very much.
ખૂબ ખૂબ આભાર અખિલભાઈ. આપે કહ્યું તેમ પ્રતિભા સંપન્ન અને નીતિવાન માણસો જો કોન્સ્ટિટ્યુશન ઉપર કામ કરશે તો આપણું કોન્સ્ટિટ્યુશન આગળ જશે. અમે આપને આવામાંના જે એક જોઈએ છીએ અને તેથી જ આવા પ્રકારના ચુકાદાઓ આપની પાસેથી મળ્યા છે. ખૂબ ખૂબ આભાર. લોર્ડ ભીખુભાઈને વિનંતી કરીશ કે અધ્યક્ષશ્રીએ પ્રવચન આપે. લોર્ડ ભીખુભાઈ.
Say a few words about Justice Qureshi's brilliant lecture. I have a few thoughts on what he has just said, and given the opportunity, I want to be able to share them with you. Now, I would rather do that, and in order to be able to do that, I should sit and talk so that it looks like a seminar between equals, rather than a pundit standing there and giving lectures to an audience. So if you all agree, I shall sit and talk in the spirit of a dialogue, right? Now, the Justice has given us an excellent talk on the Constitution and the Mahatma. Now, there are three or four questions that this raises. Not just what would be a Gandhian Constitution look like, there is also a question: what is the point of a constitution? Gandhi was a man who was challenging all sorts of things. His first question would be, you want to draft a constitution, you want me to draft a constitution, but what is the point of it? And if he had thought very hard, which I am sure he would have said constitutions are of three kinds. There are some which provide rules of governance. Who has authority to do what, in what situation? There are, like the American Constitution, shortest and the sweetest, and tells you exactly how the country will be governed. Or you have constitution which are statements of national identity, which don't merely talk about who governs what, but provides the design of the structure of the state. Not just government, structure of the state. And tells you how, what kind of a state we want to be, a statement of national identity. Or thirdly, the Marxist, the communist, would be thinking of a constitution as a utopia, a statement of what we would one day like our society to be, free of untouchability and free of casteism and all that. So Gandhi would have said, the question that I would like to ask on Gandhi's behalf is, which of these three would be Gandhi's idea of a constitution? Rules of governance, full stop. Statement of national identity, or going further, a vision of India. India of my dream, India of villages. So that's the first question I would want to ask about Gandhi and the constitution. And my own view is roughly that he would think of a constitution more as a halfway between a statement of national identity and a statement of the kind of society that he would like to see. That's first point about the constitution. The second point would be, what would he put in that constitution? After all, here was a man who was always inventive. What would he put in it, and what would he take out of the constitution as it has emerged? And what would he have put in it? Let's start with that first question. And I think he would have put two things into it, which are sadly missing. First, Swaraj. He would have said, the ultimate goal of anything in life is to increase my capacity for Swaraj. I should be able to rule myself. Where is Swaraj in the Constitution? What are the provisions in the Constitution which conduce to Swaraj, which you can say support Swaraj? Swaraj for Gandhi is connected with Swadeshi. Swaraj for him is connected with, I will talk about that in a second, Satyagraha. Swaraj is connected with lots of things, with village economy and all that. And none of that appears. The Constitution is elaborate on political and legal affairs, but rather quiet on the economic affairs. It has nothing to say about the kind of economy that the country would need. So you could immediately see that the second thing he would want to put there, which I would like to put there, maybe Justice Qureshi might disagree, is the whole provision on Swaraj. And that would mean, brings me to my third point, which is if you ask Gandhi or his followers or others about the preamble. Preamble is a complicated statement. It's supposed to be the summation, the essence of the Constitution, and supposed to provide principles to guide the interpretation of the Constitution. Now, if you look at the preamble, what does it want India to be? And what is the important thing to note? There are several important things to note, but one of the most important things to note is that it is the one of the few places where the word democracy and republic are both used. Now, what's the difference? What is the difference between a democracy and a republic? If you look at the Constituent Assembly debates, when Pandit Nehru introduced the Objectives Resolution, the first draft, it simply says India shall be a democracy, but no reference to republic. And when a few people in the assembly asked, why not, he said democracy virtually includes republic. That was Panditji's answer. A few weeks later, when the same resolution was proposed, the word republic was there, but not the word democracy. And Panditji was asked why, and he said the word democracy is included in the word. Panditji could be a Panditji for every occasion. Finally, when the last draft of the Constitution preamble was submitted, it said India shall be a sovereign republic, sovereign democratic republic. We won't quarrel about the word sovereign. Important thing is a democratic republic. Why isn't it enough to say India is a democracy, or will be a democracy? Why do you add the word republic? Or conversely, why not simply add the word, use the word republic, India shall be a republic? Why use democracy? Why both? And that's where you begin to understand the intricacies of the debates that surrounded the Constituent Assembly. There is the whole Ambedkar Phule tradition, which talks about India as a republic. There are Nehru and others who are talking about India as a democracy, but he too talks about India as a republic. And what they mean by republic as different from democracy is this. First of all, in a democracy, as the Justice very rightly pointed out, you talk about majority and minority. In a republic, there is no majority, minority. That is a unanimous decision by the people. So India will be a republic, but republic qualified by its democratic aspirations. And also the other thing, in a republic, there is tremendous emphasis on citizenship. A republic is always linked with its correlate, a citizen. What are the obligations of the citizen? What should the citizens be doing? What should you and I be doing for the country? Our constitution is sadly silent, has no expectations of citizens. There are constitutions produced more or less at the same time, which talks about citizens having responsibility, civic responsibility to do this or to do that. Ours are rather quiet on this, but then there are reasons for this. So the next question then is, was Gandhi in favor of democratic republic? Why did he want republic? Precisely because he wanted to show that majority is not enough, and also because he wanted a certain kind of state, a certain kind of society. And that links me to the last point, and then I should stop, is the distinction that is drawn between democracy and representation. What is a representative democracy? There is democracy where people directly vote and so on. What do we do? Or what have we done? And what have most countries done? You elect representatives, and these representatives govern the country, the majority of those representatives. So what do we have? We don't have rule by people. They have washed their hands off once they've elected representatives. It is these 300, 200, 400 people we elect who take all the major decisions. So what we have is not democracy as such. What we have is representative democracy, or democracy as implemented through, as articulated through representatives. Now that raises a question. What happens if representatives do things which people don't want, which happens all the time? right? Whether it's Modi Sahib or somebody else, it doesn't matter. We want some things and the government doesn't do it, or the opposite. What happens then? Well, in a representative democracy, representatives have the final word. The principle of parliamentary sovereignty in Britain. Same thing here. The parliament has the final word, representatives have the final word. And you then hope that people can overrule them, but there are no provisions for this. If you look at the constitution of South Africa, there are provisions for recalling representatives and all that. Ours doesn't. So I would simply say, and just one last point, I can't resist mentioning this, and that is, in the Gandhian case, would the constitution have some provision for non-violence? That would be unique. Constitution is supposed to be a theory regulating violence. Can you have the opposite, a constitution which is based on non-violence? And there, I think, a very interesting tension arises, and that is, I have always wondered why Mahatma is called a prophet of non-violence. I could have easily called him prophet of regulated violence. If you read him carefully, from the time he was in South Africa onwards, what happens? When he says violence, what does violence mean? What does non-violence mean? Ahimsa. He doesn't prefer the word non-violence. Nor do I, for all kinds of reasons. Ahimsa. What does it mean? You don't kill. All right. In Gandhi's ashram, there is a calf suffering from an interminable cancer. And everybody advises Gandhi to put an end to his life because it can't struggle for 2 weeks, excruciating pain. Gandhi announces in his weekly that this is what he's going to do. He does it. The amount of abuse he got was simply intolerable. But he justified it, saying killing the calf was an act of non-violence, not violence. I wasn't killing it for fun. I killed it in its own interest. And in a typical Gandhian fashion, he says, it's a case of non-violent violence. That's maybe, what about the next step? Monkeys in the ashram, spoiling the crop. Gandhi said, well, you can use force against them and drive them away. But what about a terrorist? Supposing I'm in a room surrounded by half a dozen people and a madman walks in waving his gun. Gandhi says, kill him. Kill him. Yes. And then he says, to elaborate, my maker will not forgive me. If I told him in self-defense that I was prevented by non-violence from saving those children. So, Kashmir, we know Gandhi's vaccinations. Khera, when he comes back from South Africa and raises soldiers for the army, what happens? More important, he strike, boycott British cloth. As a result of that, lots of people are suffering or dying in Manchester and Lancashire. They write to Gandhi saying, look, I mean, this is what your action is doing, killing us. They said, that's all right, but we are exercising our right to live. So if this happens, it's incidental. Now, you see the way. Or Jews protesting against the ghettos in Poland and other places. And he said, it's almost non-violence, because a few Jews protesting against thousands of German troops, not being able to kill, it's violence, but it's almost non-violence. Now, if you put all these exceptions together, what kind of a theory of non-violence does Mahatma give? Lots of pacifists in Britain were very unhappy with him, saying, look, you are sanctioning violence in all these cases. But Gandhi says, I have to be guiding a country. I can't dream. Practical guidance. Plus, my own thinking about what's going on. So what we begin to see here is not just non-violence, associate non-violence with Gandhi, I think, is ultimately a mistake, because it turns him into a pacifist, and lots of Quakers and others in Britain expected him to be a pacifist, and he was not, and they were disappointed. So I would say that here is a man who is immensely complex, cannot be easily classified as a man of non-violence or this or something else, a man who was constantly thinking, theorizing about his own experience, and a country, and if I may just end on this controversial note, so far I have been non-controversial, which is here is a man who, I say this with some hesitation, whom the country never really took to. If you look at Gandhi, and this is where I'm going to be controversial because I feel strongly on this, if we cared for Gandhi, would Gandhi have been dead soon after he died? Where is the Gandhian voice? Where is the Gandhian movement? Either on Babri Masjid, I wrote about it, saying if Gandhi had been faced with Babri Masjid, would he have allowed it to go on for 55 years? Or would he have said, no, I'm going to take a stand, I go and sit there and let these thugs come and do what they want to. Or I shall send women like Sushila Nair and others to do satyagraha. Let those idiots come and molest these women if they have the guts. Could he not have done any something? Would we not have done something about corruption so pervasive in our society? Would the old man simply have turned a blind eye saying, Chalta hai, this is our nature? Why is Gandhi forgotten? Why is there not a single movement of Gandhian kind? Which means what? That Bapu we loved, but Bapu we chose to forget. And if that is the case, then I think Indian psyche needs to be looked at very carefully to understand our very complex relation with Gandhi. And in just two sentences, our complex relation to Gandhi was this. There are three Gandhis, not just one. There is man Gandhi, who gets old, who does brahmacharya, who does all those kinds of wonderful things and appears as a colossus, a giant of a man. Who in fact, God says, killed him on the second attempt. Remember, first attempt he had gone to kill him with a dagger. He was caught by a couple of people in the ashram. They took him to Gandhiji and said, look, here is the man who came to kill you. Gandhi said, let him go. In fact, he even said, come and stay in my ashram for 2 weeks and let's see if you can change me or I can change you. The man decided to go. Gandhi said, let him go. 2 weeks later, he came to finish the job. So there is Gandhi, the man, whose death has this grandeur about it, this enormous greatness on all kinds of things. Then there is Gandhi, the leader of Satyagraha, the fighter for our independence. And there is Gandhi of Rachanatmak Karyakram, which is, you know, Hindu-Muslim unity, solidarity, economy and all that. There are three Gandhis. We took to only the first Gandhi. Gandhi the man. We kept, even now when people talk about Gandhi the great man, it's always, you know, Bapu, Bapu, Bapu. The Bapu is the first Bapu. And that's the Bapu who lived this great life. But the Bapu was not in politics. In politics it was a different Bapu. And that we never seem to have registered. There have been no satyagrahas after Gandhi's death. I mean, after all, it's somebody like the Lagerahu Munnabai. MBBS, I mean that sort of thing. But these are complete misunderstanding, and I remember telling Shabana Azmi, this is not what Gandhi would have done. This poor man whose pension is denied until bakshish is given, and he then throws in his chaddi and says, take this as a prize. Now Gandhi would call it blackmail, it's not satyagraha. So the point is, when you come to satyagraha, we haven't seen any. And when you get to Rachanatmak Karyakram, maybe Ramlal Bhai and others did, and Prakash Bhai did a few works here and there. But beyond that, I don't see any kind of systematic movement. So if we loved Gandhi Bapu, that's fine, but the Bapu is dead. What now? And that's where we have to turn to people like Justice Qureshi, who has spoken with great wisdom and great perception about the Mahatma. And I think ultimately, unless Gandhi has to be alive, We can't allow him to die. He is our capital. He is our capital. In dark times, you get inspiration from him. Just as people talking about ekalo jane, that even in current regime, an isolated individual walking with a staff can affirm himself. He can do that. So I think we need that kind of spirit. And to remind us of that, the lecture for today, organized by Mandaben and delivered by Justice Qureshi, has been a great step in the right direction. Thank you very much.
खूब आभार भिखू भाई बार प्रस्ताव रजू करे
बने व्याख्यानों एटला फुलफिलिंग था कि मने लगे कि पछी कहीं बोलवानुं बहु रहेतुं नथी हूँ मानु छू त्या सुधी जे प्रश्न बने जणे उभा कर्या ए प्रश्न अपना मन की अंदर घणा घणो वखत સળવળ્યા કરશે અને ક્યાંક ને ક્યાંક આપણે જવાબ શોધવા માટે મથીશું જ્યાં હોઈશું જે કરતા હોઈશું એ પહેલું અનઆન્સર જે રાખ્યું છે ટાઇટલ અખિલભાઈએ કે વેધર ડ્રીમ ઓફ ગાંધીજી ઇઝ ફૂલફિલ્ડ ઓર નોટ એક બહુ અનફોર્ચ્યુનેટ વસ્તુ આ દેશની અંદર છે કે કોન્સ્ટિટ્યુશનની જેટલી એ પબ્લિક ડોક્યુમેન્ટ છે પણ જેટલું પબ્લિક ડોમેનની અંદર આવવું જોઈએ એટલું હજી આવ્યું નથી કદાચ એની અંદર આપણે બધા રિસ્પોન્સિબલ છીએ અને વી નીડ ટુ પ્લે ઓન દેટ અને ભીખુભાઈએ જે કહ્યું કે ગાંધી હેઝ ટુ બી અલાઈવ અને એ ગાંધીને અલાઈવ કરવાની પણ આપણા બધાની એક જવાબદારી ઊભી થાય છે આ સમજ સાથે આજનો કાર્યક્રમ અહીંયા પૂરો કરીએ છીએ પૂરો કરતાં પહેલાં હું અખિલભાઈનો ખૂબ આભાર માનું છું એટલું બધું સરળ વ્યક્તિત્વ છે કે આમંત્રણ આપ્યા પછી બહુ જ એટલી બધી હોમલીનેસ અનુભવી છે એમની સાથે કે આ આખા કાર્યક્રમના આયોજનની અંદર કોઈ પ્રકારની મુશ્કેલી પડી નથી ભીખુભાઈ તો મને અચાનક જ ખબર પડી અખિલભાઈની આ આવી પછી કે ભીખુભાઈ ઇન્ડિયામાં છે અને મેં પૂછ્યું અને ફોન ઉપર જ એમણે કહ્યું કે ના તમે હું આવી જઈશ એટલે બંને વિદ્વાનોએ આ પ્રસંગે આવવાનું કબૂલ્યું અને રામલાલભાઈની સ્મૃતિમાં જે કરીએ છીએ એ સ્મૃતિને સજીવન કરી એ માટે બંનેનો ખૂબ આભાર માનું છું આપ સૌનો ખૂબ આભાર કે તમે બધા અહીંયા આવો છો આ ચર્ચામાં ભાગ લો છો અને ક્યાંક ને ક્યાંક એના પડઘા પડે છે એ દેખાય પણ છે એ માટે આપ સૌનો પણ ખૂબ ખૂબ આભાર થેન્ક યુ ઓલ
આપણે સૌ રાષ્ટ્રગીત ગાઈ અને પછી છૂટા પડીશું
જનગણ મન અધિનાયક જય હે ભારત ભાગ્ય વિધાતા પંજાબ સિંધુ ગુજરાત મરાઠા દ્રાવિડ ઉત્કલ બંગ વિંધ્ય હિમાચલ યમુના ગંગા ઉચ્છલ જલધિ તરંગ તવ શુભ નામે જાગે તવ શુભ આશિષ માંગે ગાહે તવ જય ગાથા જનગણ મંગલદાયક જય હે ભારત ભાગ્ય વિધાતા જય હે જય હે જય હે જય 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 હે
સૌ કોઈનો આભાર આપણે છૂટા